All right, this is a hearing on the tiny house, I guess we'll call it. Couple of ground rules that I'd like to put out there first. First, we're going to combine the two items on this hearing together since they are both dealing with the same parcel. And some ground rules. I'll ask the petitioner to get up here and give her presentation, and then the members of the committee will, or the zoning board will ask questions. Then I'll ask for questions from the public. I'll ask that town residents only, and then after everybody in town has had their questions answered, and I ask that you don't repeat questions that somebody else has gone over already. And then if there's time allows, I'll let somebody from the outside ask questions or make comments. So with that, Sarah, if you want to give your presentation. You can, well.
Yeah, it's Richard.
This is a new venue for us. We've never had our meeting here.
I understand. Okay. Mind if I just sit then? Okay, so I'm just going to speak for probably around 15 minutes. It might seem a little bit repetitive to those of you who have heard my story, but I wanted to make sure I was comprehensive.
I might add that in your presentation, just make it pertinent to this particular lot and that building on that particular lot, not, you know, a sales pitch for tiny houses or whatever.
Okay, so I'll read what my speech here that I have. Hello, my name is Sarah Hastings. I recently graduated with a degree in Architectural and Environmental Studies from Mount Holyoke College. My purpose in life is to promote environmental conservation and consciousness through design. I represent my values thoroughly through my everyday actions and lifestyle, and I am inspired to share my experiences with other people. Moreover, I represent a greater movement toward environmental and social solutions that cannot be avoided. In early May of 2015, I found a freshly assembled robin's nest perched on a beam that supports my cantilevered bedroom. The bird's home was made from twigs, mud, small pieces of debris, and probably even some of my own hair. I thought the principles of its composition weren't too far different from my own home's. Both were assembled ecologically. I built mine from salvage and local materials as well. And both homes lay lightly on their landscape, not to permanently imprint their environment. I was excited that, as one of the few masts in the part in a vast parking lot, my house could support a family of birds. I observed it each day for several weeks. At the time I found the nest, I had just finished writing a 50-page thesis in architectural studies at Mount Holyoke. Mine was a peculiar and laborious experiment for a college project. It resulted in a thick binder containing the designs for my future home, detailed documentation of its construction, an overarching history and legal assessment of tiny movable homes in America. Alongside this big binder was my actual 200 square foot home on wheels, large for a thesis, but very tiny for a residence. I presented a tour of my new home to my professors, showing them the platform for my mindful and environmentally responsible lifestyle. I was handed my diploma with paint still under my fingernails. I was still finishing the very last touches on the house. One day, after all the students left for their next phase of life, I went back to my almost completed house at its building site in a Mount Holyoke parking lot to find five pearly blue eggs in that nest below my bed. Sometimes Mama Bird would be home, keeping her territory safe while I carefully painted my cabinets and window frames. I was careful not to disturb my unexpected tenant and her precious work. One following morning, I woke to the flapping and squawking. The first thing my groggy eyes saw was a family of naked little birdies levitating with clumsy conviction outside my window. It wasn't long before the family relocated to their next phase of life, leaving me alone to determine my next steps. In departing, they left their home tucked into mine. Now, it was mid-June, and I was finally preparing for my own departure. Unlike the robins, I'd be taking my home with me. After months of seeking a spot to rent land for my tiny house, I compiled about 10 sites where both the landowner and the surrounding neighborhood were welcoming towards tiny homes. Still, I was well aware that not one of these towns or locations would classify a tiny home like mine as a legal dwelling. As a matter of fact, well before I began building my home, I knew that very few towns across the USA would account for tiny homes with their zoning and building codes. Was this going to stop me from demonstrating a way that I had faith for, that I had faith in? No, it was not. Now, please do not see this as a situation as disregard for regulation, nor do I think I should be an exception to the rules based on my particular passions and experiments. I am fascinated by the positive impact of government on a local scale. Nevertheless, I have noticed that many policies do not account for current environmental and financial tragedy, nor do they assess innovative approaches for change, and I refuse to assimilate into such a system. In taking residence in a 200-square-foot home on wheels, I knew I was doing something that was not technically allowed, but which was a genuine effort toward future improvements. I looked at my role models for guidance in this tough situation. Catherine Switzer registered and ran the Boston Marathon in 1967 when women were not allowed, and was almost physically pulled from the race as she ran it. She is now a role model to millions for putting her foot down over and over again until she strode across that finish line. Henry David Thoreau refused to pay his taxes in rejection of slavery, and he also experimentally built a tiny house to exemplify simple values and environmental conservation. He was then thrown in jail, but now he is one of the world's most prominent philosophical leaders. Time and time again, intellectual and moral action is crippled because of stubborn rules. This time, I would like to see the individual, me, Sarah Hastings, and the regulators work together to come to a holistic solution for the future. I am honestly frustrated by any resistance to honest efforts to remediate these hardships, especially when these efforts are on a small scale. I have a commitment to leadership and networking on the local level so that positive change can be replicated. I actually noticed neglect for proper management for space very early on. I grew up in Braintree, Massachusetts, a nice historic town which unfortunately lacks forest and farmland, and where plats of McMansions and chain stores are going up with no insight or strategic plan. This frustrated me from a very early age, before I even knew what zoning was. I just knew that space was more precious than the way people were managing it. When I moved to Western Massachusetts in 2011 for college, I took a deep breath of fresh air and felt tremendous gratitude for the local priorities that put landscape preservation and sustainability high on the list. In determining where in the Pioneer Valley I might make my home, I read about Hadley's values. And I quote this from Hadley's master plan. Hadley is a town that values, protects, and supports its rural heritage, agricultural resources, and farming way of life. A town that manages and guides development to be sensitive to the natural environment, our rural character, and the financial well-being of the community. A town that actively preserves and protects its natural resources and open space. A town that values its quality of life, sense of community, and rural small town atmosphere. A town that is aesthetically pleasing and that protects its scenic views, waterways, rural streets, and historic features. A town that values and supports its educational system and that provides a broad range of educational and recreational opportunities. A town that manages the growth of housing to meet the needs of its residents in balance with the preservation of its rural character and agricultural resources. A town that encourages strategic economic development by balancing commercial, retail, and light industrial land uses along Route 9. So that's part of the master plan. I thought this might be a place that would embrace new solutions to environmental and social care. I believe so deeply in alternative housing options that I was not going to sit and wait for someone else to pave the way. It is a lot easier to wait for someone else to do all the work and get pretty messy. Well, I am proud to be that someone else. There are not enough options, especially for people my age. As a freshman in college, I looked at my future with foresight and concern. I did not want to have to live with roommates for 5, 10, or 15 years after I graduated. My goal was to be able to look after my own garden and take care of my surroundings, to be able to work on my house and build a dream. I would not be able to afford property without sacrificing 60 or more hours a week to a wage. I decided I would do something different no matter what. The sad truth is that if I were not living in my tiny house, I would be joining hordes of other recent graduates in illegal apartments, in basements, or I could revert to living in my parents' attic. They are the only affordable options for people my age. The tiny house model caught my eye. I dreamed about parking my home on a farm and being able to support myself without working more than 40 hours a week. I dreamed of having the time to read and write. I was not willing to approach my well-investigated dreams with any degree of hesitancy. I was not going to merely dip my toe into this tiny house thing. I was going to dive into it and continue to demonstrate its position in the community. Now, just some additional context. I started designing my home when I was 18, and now I'm 22 living in it. When I first started, there were only several to a dozen solid examples of tiny houses to research online. Some tiny homes would register as a camper and parked at a campground. Well, I don't call my house a camper. It's a permanent home complete with exceptional insulation. Other tiny homes chose to dodge their town's inspection radar. And sometimes they'd get caught and sometimes they wouldn't. But I don't think this example will be well sustained. So early on, I decided to be very open about my tiny house and its systems. I wrote on my blog about the parks, which complied closely with international building codes, like my electric, my ventilation, and my roof pitch, etc., and the aspects which I would design and test myself to ensure a safe environment. By the time I was a senior in college, there were thousands and thousands of blogs dedicated to tiny homes. A popular tiny house documentary on Netflix, an influx of design features and magazines about the concept, and 3 tiny house TV shows in the making. I myself had been contacted and interviewed by Home and Garden Television and several other publications regarding my project by the time I graduated. I constantly am contacted by people around the state, the country, and even the world who admire my home and want to achieve their own simple dream. Preschoolers, high schoolers, and retirees want to achieve their own simple dream and have expressed personal interest in owning a small or tiny home. To add, this kind of action is what colleges are now teaching about and promoting. Several local colleges are specifically using tiny houses as a case study to teach students about eco-friendly design. However, even with all the hype and promotion, tiny houses still don't have a place, leaving these dwellings in a deep gray area with zoning and codes. As my journey has continued, I have had growing frustration with how homes like mine have been placed on a pedestal, yet nobody in office is taking a look at how alternative homes can be accommodated or regulated. So last June, I decided it could be my job. Over the summer, I had tried to find ways to get involved and create conversation about tiny homes. I remember using my 10-minute lunch break at the soil lab to try to contact officials, because good luck trying to reach anyone after 3:30 p.m. And knowing that housing is a multifaceted area where health, safety, and economy are primary, I contacted a variety of people at the Massachusetts State House, people in the local town office, and other local people who have dealt in depth with town zoning and town meetings. But people's jobs were spread thin, and my requests were put on the back burner. While working my first job as a soil analyst, I kept up with educational outreach events about tiny homes in order to raise awareness in my free time. I have spoken at both kindergartens and high schools, at a public event for a real estate agency in Cambridge, in front of summer camps. I held my own informational tiny house tours for the public as well. When people express interest in building their own tiny home to me, which happens very, very, very frequently, I am honest and forewarn them that it will be difficult to do this legally. I moved to the property of Ron and Donna Adams on June 24th, 2015, where I have been paying $300 per month for a rent. Prior to moving, I met with the town inspector and after the electrical inspector to inquire about how receptive the town might be towards my tiny home on the legal end. Taking my investigation into consideration, I decided to move to this town that seemed to mirror my own values for historic preservation, environmental care, and agricultural priorities. From the day I moved to Hadley, my heart has felt at home and connected to what it loves. I enjoy biking to work and to the local stores, jogging around the neighborhood, and learning how to grow food. Ron and Donna taught me all about their crops and tools and welcomed me and my boyfriend Joe's help on the farm. We have had a special community here and we work so well together. Donna and I share exciting plans for next year's garden and beekeeping. My extremely positive experience with integrating my house into this neighborhood makes me wonder if other farmers in the area could use a tenant helper in this form. Being one of the pioneers in the tiny house movement, I encounter obstacles that make my efforts towards a simple lifestyle a full-time job. This constant work is worth it when in the morning I'm able to wake up and see that my garden has grown. I have hopes that other people won't have to go through such trial when they proclaim their own simple lifestyle. For instance, the electrician I hired decided to abandon our contract after I invested $2,000 of the agreed upon $3,000 into his work when I then went last summer without electricity. I finally found licensed opinions and help toward the end of the summer, and I was content. So that was just a small blip of frustration. Until one day, I got a phone call from a reporter who informed me on a persistent comment that the paper received about my home that violated the zoning law in Hadley. The commenter was the one who gave out my private phone number to the newspaper. And with further investigation, I came to find that someone who I thought took genuine interest in my home, in my tiny house project, and substantiated proper code for small dwellings, actually reported my home to the town and to the newspaper without ever speaking to me about his heated discomfort with the entire tiny house concept. I then received a very expected zoning violation. But this zoning notice, as inconvenient and demoralizing as it may seem, has not altered my plans. It has only pushed me to relay my message that many tiny house residents are trying to perpetuate. It has opened up this platform for me to finally show that small homes like mine deserve a place. I have worked tirelessly to promote my home from the beginning and am excited to defend it after being ignored by officials over the summer. I have a detailed argument about why tiny homes allowed by special permit would be attractive in the town of Hadley. But first, I need to defend my own home. I am here at this meeting to propose that I be granted a variance, or at the very least, be given the time to see this through, to create an opportunity for Hadley residents to assess whether they think tiny home permits match the town's values. I created a petition I published online and shared with my Facebook page. A few friends and family members signed it, along with some neighbors and other tiny house advocates in the area. I was pleased to find, though, that my petition had been shared widely through the media, and I received 1,400 signatures. That's 1,400 signatures. They come from almost 40 states, a dozen countries, but the bulk of the signatures are local. I have nearly 100 signatures from Hadley right now, and they say that they support my home in Hadley and the opportunity to vote on a bylaw amendment that will account for all tiny homes. To reiterate, today I am here to ask the Hadley Zoning Board of Appeals if my tiny house may stay on the property of Ron and Donna Adams by way of variance, or at the very least, until the situation for tiny homes is fairly assessed, considering that there is a strong movement toward alternative housing that has not yet been accounted for in Hadley. This extension will enable me to propose a formal bylaw amendment to be voted on this spring, I have a team of people who want to join me in writing up this bylaw amendment, and my petition shows clear evidence that there must be further consideration for homes like mine. Ron and Donna Adams own 3.4 acre lot, on 42 East Street. They have a productive farm and yield a variety of crops and herbs for their farm stand. There is a large tobacco barn on the property, and I have parked my home between it and the residence, about 55 feet from both the garage and the barn. My house is built to a trailer, which I insulated with rigid foam insulation and jacked to the ground. The dimensions are 27 feet by 8.5 feet by 13 feet tall for a total of about 190 square feet. As far as my electrical contract confirms, my outlets are as close to code as my small floor plan allows. My house is a perfect example of a safe tiny home, and I would like to create a more comprehensive plan for how tiny homes can be accounted fairly. There are 5 counties in California that allow tiny homes on wheels as secondary dwellings, some under the condition that the tenant be a caregiver or a helper on the land, and some being unconditional towards the tenant's occupation. Several other towns in the USA have reassessed their zoning bylaws and have revised them to include tiny homes. Nantucket is the only detectable example in New England that allows and regulates alternative, secondary, and even tertiary dwelling units and attached bedrooms so far. But their revision was also pretty recent. I know Hadley could be a valuable and logical town to assess tiny homes as a new option in housing. Section 26 of Hadley's zoning bylaw states that all accessory apartments must be within the main dwelling unit, and only one dwelling unit is permitted per lot. I am in violation of this section and some elements of the International Building Code due to my small room sizes. The influx of signatures and emails that I received show that Section 26 could use some revisiting. Section 13.7 of Hadley's zoning bylaw states that mobile homes are permitted on the floodplain between May 1st and October 31st. That's a total of 179 days of the year. My home is 3/4 of a mile from this designated floodplain, the firm floodplain, and is on what is scientifically defined as the floodplain. This is favorable because it shows that mobile homes have already been assessed as a positive residential model for sensitive habitats. I think that Section 13.7 could be more comprehensive. To build on that, Chapter 17 of Zoning Bylaw expresses Hadley's priority to preserving farmland and aiding in farming landowners' investments. I quote, "To permanently protect farmland and agricultural soils in the town of Hadley, to protect farmland, property values, and provide a fair economic return to owners of property restricted from further development, and to foster compact commercial and industrial development in central areas served by public infrastructure." Being on a movable foundation, my home works to in accordance with Hadley's land preservation efforts while still complying with the valued vernacular architectural style of the neighborhood. Also important to note is the financial help that my house supplies to my landlords. With unaffordable mortgages in town and across the nation, a small monthly rent supplies valuable assistance. I am also hired for farm work on my landlord's farm, which presents further purpose for my home and I. Luckily, Massachusetts already has a set of guidelines that allow for composting toilets, very frequently used in tiny homes. In addition, Massachusetts is now authorizing gray water reuse piloting approvals. I quote, "They allow innovative gray water systems such as gray water gardens, and that due to information from a University of Massachusetts study, the Department of Environmental Protection has proposed regulatory changes to Title V for gray water system." This has to do with septic tanks. My house uses both a composting toilet and a functioning gray water garden. All of my water-soluble products are biodegradable, and I test my soil seasonally. My bylaw amendment proposal is well on its way and will be completed for the February 17th deadline and will be submitted alongside a petition of 100 or more Hadley residents. My work shows that I deserve to remain home in the town of Hadley and proves that the tiny house movement should be comprehensively considered this year. Thank you.
That's it. Okay. Members of the board, any questions?
I do have a couple questions. Do you know the size of the lot on which the main house and your tiny house are sitting in square feet?
Oh, I don't know square feet, but whatever 3.4 acres translates to. Okay.
And are you using, what are you using for heat?
I have an electric heater.
So you have
high
electric?
High efficiency electric heater, yes.
So you have electric hooked up?
Yes, I do.
And where is it hooked to?
It's hooked to the main residential.
Okay, thanks. That's Joe.
Randy, you have any questions? The inspections as far as electric and plumbing and so forth, when you were constructing the house, you said in South Hadley, who did the inspections on that?
Well, Mount Holyoke was very helpful because they have their own facilities management group, so they have licensed electricians and builders that came and made sure everything was built safely. I have photos of the entire process, how every wall and everything, every single thing was built, if there ever need be a question, because there's no actual standards for tiny houses. You know, you don't need a building license to build one, but you do need some kind of, I think there should be a way that people can reside in one and get a permit of a residency. So that's why I kept such close record of that. But I had a licensed electrician work on the project I had mentioned who had breached the contract and decided it was no longer his responsibility, although his contract said otherwise. And so he, as far as that contract is concerned, he said all the work was done to code, and I would like to have that revised by someone who knows a lot about
it. But does nobody from the town of Hadley, both electrical inspector and plumbing inspector, have it?
The electrical inspector, let me clarify, has been to the property of Ron and Donna Adams, and they saw how it was hooked up, and he said it was hooked up properly. And he had not stepped inside of the house, but I actually am hopeful that he will come and inspect it soon.
Now, he said it was hooked up properly to the main house, right?
From the main house to my little house. It has the proper proper gauge wire, proper hookup.
But has your tiny house been inspected as a unit, as a separate unit, officially inspected?
Well, there's no one to, I can't find someone that would officially inspect my house because it falls into such a deep gray area.
Electrical inspector?
The electrical inspector I could invite to see how the electrical outlets are.
I mean, that's traditionally, yeah. To get to the point of a certificate of occupancy, you have to have a plumbing inspector, electrical inspector, a building inspector sign off on the structure before it can be occupied.
We've been close, been in close communication all along.
But do you have a certificate of occupancy?
No, I do not. And I'm hoping to set a standard for people that want to do this because I am a pioneer in this and trying to figure it out on my own.
And the composting toilets, there's nothing hooked into any sewer system or septic tank at this point?
Not at this point. In order to get it officially like checked off, you have to show that a septic tank can be installed if there is any problem.
Okay. I'd like to hear some comments from the audience at this point. Jim?
Jim Maximowski. I'm on the planning board. The planning board has taken no vote on this, no official stance, so I'm speaking simply as a member of the planning board, but no official, obviously. Just want to make that clear. This is just a hearing on appeal of the building inspector's cease and desist, correct?
Right.
Not a variance?
No.
Okay. So, obviously, at least in my opinion, you know, this is in violation of the zoning bylaws. A variance would require a variance and would have to show hardship. And there is no hardship, in my opinion, again, on this property. He doesn't meet any of the definitions of state law of hardship. So really, the only choice here is to get the zoning changed at town meeting, which you're pursuing. As far as the zoning violation, zoning, at least according to master in law, to my knowledge, does not have anything in it about tiny houses or size of houses. That is building code. The zoning simply states multiple residences, side yard setback, but I believe it is against master in laws for zoning to mention size of a minimum or maximum size of a house. That's a state law issue, not a Hadley zoning code, if you would. The lady is pursuing the correct avenue, in my opinion, of going for a zone change. You know, draw it up, go to town meeting, presentation, planning board holds appropriate hearings and stuff like that. I was going to mention, you know the date, so it's good. You've got a little over, less, just about a month to make sure it's complete. So don't wait till the last minute, because the planning board meets the first and third Tuesdays of the month, as you probably are aware of that too. So, you know, try to be sooner rather than later when you do whatever you're doing, okay? The planning board has taken no stand, and, you know, as far as tiny house goes, you know, like I said, we don't really have a stand on a tiny house. It's more about the zoning issue in general of multiple residences per lot and being in one building. So if it's two buildings, you know, like I said, that's the zoning amendment. Thank you.
Anyone else?
Shel Horowitz, 16 Barstow Lane. I speak to you wearing a few different hats. One is as a resident of Hadley since 1998 and a member for, I don't know, Jim, how long was I in there? 9 years, 10 years?
Of
the Long Range Plan Implementation Committee, which is charged with incorporating the bylaw from which Sarah read a piece into the plan into some of the bylaws, and we have brought forward a number of pieces over the years that have become part of Hadley's bylaws. And also as someone who is recognized as an international expert on green business, author of award-winning and best-selling books on that topic, international speaker, and with some knowledge of how this fits into the wider perspective. With that wider perspective, I want to talk a little bit about Hadley and energy policy in the United States, because Hadley is actually a leader in this. We have both industrial scale solar farms and one house installations. We have, as far as I know, the oldest solar home in the country, which I live in, built in 1743, and the second oldest solar and the oldest geothermal house across the street from me, owned by Rick and Mary Thayer, built in 1747. To give this a little perspective, my house was built the year that Thomas Jefferson was born. It's an old, old house. When that house was built, houses were colonial and they had large families. If you had a couple with 10 children in a 2,000 square foot colonial house built in the 18th or 19th century, the amount of square footage you had per person was actually less than Sarah has in her house. Hadley is also continuing its leadership in environmental issues with the construction of only, I believe, the second farm to methane generation plant in the state of Massachusetts, which is also located on the Barstow farm where I live. My neighbors have put this thing in and they are selling power back to the grid to power, I believe it's 250 houses. And we are actually in discussions with them about converting our heating from oil to heat waste from cow poop and food waste. So this is leadership that the town has shown. There are also a number of properties around town in which the conformance with zoning is not there because the buildings were constructed earlier. There are houses, lots with a house in the front and one in the back, for example. These things are out there and they do not seem to be detrimental to the neighborhoods. Excuse me a moment. There's also, I think, you heard in Sarah's presentation a number of larger issues involving affordability of housing. In a farm community like Hadley, this is very crucial. In an area where people finish their studies and would like to put down roots and find jobs, this is crucial. I'm very fortunate in that my children are not crushed by student debt, but many people Sarah's age are. And it's very, very tough. I remember when we bought our first house, it took us 2 years to find one we could afford. So if we want to continue to have opportunities for future generations, we need to look at this. I do believe there needs to be standards. I do believe there needs to be a process where something can come in and be looked at and say, okay, this tweak needs to be done on the electrical or on the plumbing, whatever it is, on the septic. There should be some standards for governance, and it would be expected if this new bylaw you're proposing passes that you would be subject to that, I would think. There's also the last issue I really want to talk about is the idea that we have been incredibly lucky in Hadley with being able to preserve large swaths of land, both for farming and for outdoor recreation and conservation purposes. We have one of the highest rates in the state of that. That's another area in which we've shown leadership. But we've been really lucky because our zoning permits really horrible suburban sprawl, and it's just been amazing that we've managed to avoid the worst excesses that have eaten up towns like Braintree. Tim, am I right that Hadley has 2-acre zoning in most areas?
No. Less than one.
Okay. Good. You can see a historic example of tiny houses right across the river in Northampton. It's called Laurel Park. Laurel Park was built as a camp meeting site in the late 19th century. The houses are very small. They're not as small as Sarah's house, but they're way smaller than conventional houses. And what they've done is they've left most of the land undeveloped and open for the residents to enjoy it. I think in a farming community like Hadley, that's a model that we can look at with some pleasure and be glad to see that something like that exists just 1 mile from our border. So I will stop there and open the floor to the next person. Thank you.
Jim?
I meant to make sure I had my chance that, you know, my opinion, I think the zoning board has to uphold the building inspector's decision. But it would be also, in my opinion, we downright cruel to throw this poor lady out in the street and say you can't live there. You know, give her the chance, give her a time frame. She could be there, like, you know, the zoning amendment, if it passes, it's one thing. If it fails, then obviously she would have to probably vacate.
I don't have a question. Just I know the two were rolled into one, and just the audience may not know that Ron and Donna Adams are here in the audience. So if anybody has questions for us as well as Sarah, the article that came out in October had some things that people may want questions to the owner more than Sarah as well. So if anybody has a question for us, we're happy to address that as
well. Yes, I'd have a question.
Sure.
Both to Sarah and yourself. Why would you go ahead and do this when you have no permits, you're clearly in violation of the zoning bylaw to start with? Why would you just go ahead and do this and kind of beg for forgiveness rather than ask for permission?
Good question. That's not how we saw it so much. I know that Sarah and Tim were in conversations, and one thing that Sarah is talking about, the deep gray area, that was very clear from the beginning. Nobody said no. Nobody said yes. So I would say that we were in the strong position in that if Sarah came and things got mucky, we could tell her to leave. Her house is on wheels. So she was in a more vulnerable position. So I've always admired her trust. But I don't think that, and we are doing a lot of work on our house. Many of you have driven by and commented on that. And all the work that we're doing is through permits. So everything that we're, when we have a permit, we're allowed to do the work. The work's not done. It's something that's in process. Mm-hmm. And when it's done, it's checked off. And this is what I saw with Sarah. There wasn't yes, there wasn't no. This is a process. And Sarah certainly has guaranteed us that she wants to, as she said, not do it in the dark, not do it in the shadows. We trust that she will do everything she can to get that permit. And we will do everything we can to get that permit. In the end, we may have to part company, and that will be sad. But as I see it now, we're working towards that goal.
Right.
Brian Glazer, 30 Newton Lane. Just a question on that. Was there anybody asked if this was allowable in the town? Did you people ask anybody? Did you go to anybody in the town officials?
No. Before I left Mount Holyoke College campus, I talked to many different towns, representatives from many different towns. I talked to Tim Neihart and asked his opinion on the matter. Although he couldn't give me permission to move, I was just having a conversation assessing when can I raise my voice and try to join in on the meetings and all of that. So that was my form of assessing the situation.
Well, don't you think that it would have been a better way to come in and get permits and go to the right officials?
I wanted.
And get this done the right way? And then, you know, if it didn't work out, you could go and go the route that you're going to take now. It's like the cart in front of the horse here. You come in and you just put something down, and now you want the town to accept it. I think it would have been a better idea for you to go, you know, the proper way, like everybody else in this town has to get permits to build and put up structures. And then, you know, if there's a problem, you could take the route that you're doing. I mean, but, you know, just to come in and put something down and not to go to any officials in town and not follow the zoning laws, I can't see that happening. I mean, it shouldn't be that way. I mean, if it goes that way, I mean, everybody in town can just do whatever they want. I mean, you can go and build whatever you want, you can do whatever you want, and nobody's going to ask for any permits. And that just can't happen. I mean, there's permits, there's fees that have to be paid, you know, I can appreciate, you know, your thing here, but the laws should be followed, especially in the town of Hadley or any town. But just to start something and not ask for permission, number one, and not go through the proper permits and the payment that has to be made, I just don't think that's the right way to do it.
Just to clarify, you're allowed to park something on a property for less than 60, 90 days at a time. And I went into this knowing that I knew that years and years ago. And so I was hoping I could graduate from college, get involved, and try to change things. And I was shut down time and time again. I couldn't find anyone who wanted to speak about it. And what do I do? You know, of course, go move your house then when I already have a job. It's a very difficult situation. And I'm trying to, as a person representing this generation, I was trying to represent that. Excuse me.
Well, did you go to the building inspector at all?
I did.
And you talked to him, and what was his comments on that?
Well, if I could, I mean, Sarah and I did talk at length many, many times in regards to this when she was in college. Certainly, there is a movement going on with tiny houses, and she's part of it. We first started talking, and like she said, she went to many towns, and essentially, she said I was one of the few that would even sit down and talk to her about what the problems that she was faced with. And they are numerous. Luckily, they are changing quickly on some fronts with regard to code. Actually, just a little few months ago, I guess, maybe even less than a month ago, the international code did take upon looking at tiny houses and did modify code to allow the tiny houses to actually fall under code. And they have, and when we come out with the new code, in July, you'll see some modifications to it for that. But unfortunately, at the time Sarah came in, she wanted to put it someplace. Certainly, I told her I couldn't give her permission to do that because our zoning didn't allow it either. But she knew about the temporary time frame with regard to temporary housing of some sort. I talked to one of the selectmen about it, and I also talked to the town administrator. We actually discussed it a little bit with town council. It's just like a mobile home. You can bring a mobile home to someplace. So before I get into that, there are numerous issues at state and local level that need to be addressed at the time. And I'll do one at a time. So if you bring a mobile home in, you can park your mobile home in your driveway as a temporary basis. You have some amount of time that can stay there. Then you have to leave. You know, if you could have a relative come and visit you, set up the mobile home, yes, that's permitted in the town of, in most towns. There are some towns that totally restrict that, and certainly even very local and private ones, subdivisions have restrictions relative to that. But on her behalf, since I've worked at the state level with code, I know the gentleman there, and we got on the phone and started talking to them about this issue, and it was something that they were looking into. There was many issues relative to all the fronts, electrical, plumbing particularly, and size. And fortunately, with the change of governors, everybody in the Department of Public Safety that we were talking to left. So that front, basically trying to figure out what can be done with code issues, was stopped dead in its tracks. At the very beginning, I told Sherry that it is something that doesn't fit into code. It could be something temporary in nature, but the only way something that could happen is through some type of a modification to our zoning bylaws. And the one area that I suggested was possibly modifying the accessory apartment bylaw. There are a lot of issues with something, and one of the reasons why the planning board put the accessory apartments into the primary residence was because if it was in an outbuilding of some sort, be a garage or something else, another structure on the site, you get into a lot of logistics nightmares with regard to plumbing and electrical. And, you know, and we've had this as a problem with plumbing. If it came off the house and there was a fight, the guy just goes in and shuts off the plumbing to the house. You know, so we got all these little scenarios that can happen. And that was one of the reasons why, after time, the decision was to keep accessory bylaws strictly in the primary residence. So this could be a modification to it, but then we get into these issues and how do you deal with a lot of these problems? And it is a complicated problem.
Go.
You know, in as much as Tim brought up the trailer issue, from a historical perspective, when I first got on the planning board, I asked, this is grandfather Joe Weitzek, I said, how did the trailer issue come about? No trailers in residential area. He said, I'll tell you how. He said, when my daughter got married, my son-in-law and my daughter lived in a trailer right next to my house. He said, that was fine temporarily, but how would it look if every house had a trailer on Middle Street, every house had a trailer on West Street, every house had a trailer on Kosher Drive? And they brought it up before the town, and the town overwhelmingly said, this is not what we want. I mean, this may be a movement, but it certainly is not Hadley's movement. And if you're looking at one quaint little mobile home, it's like a quaint little chicken coop. But 1,000 of them would probably not be acceptable in town. So we have to be careful what we wish for and be careful what someone with a vision and maybe a senior thesis wishes for may not be the compatible thing for the town of Hadley.
Well, if the town of Hadley doesn't want 1,000 mobile homes, then each resident will decide for themselves whether or not they want a mobile home and will decide, no, I don't want this because it looks such a way.
You call this a mobile home?
My house is not a mobile home. It does not fit the definition of a mobile home. I'm not registered as a mobile home.
Funny, those, I see the tires on it. It's
mobile.
It's mobile.
Mobile homes are when they're situated.
It's mobile.
That's mobile.
Yes, but there's also a definition for mobile homes.
There's a definition right there, your wheels.
Well, first of all, our bylaw is very specific. You cannot invent a definition which you think is correct. We do not allow a building in the town of Hadley, except, and it lists what we allow. So when people start playing games, it's mobile, it's not mobile, the town of Hadley bylaws are very specific.
Right.
And again, I'll bring it up again. I think that, you know, if you follow the rules in the zoning laws and go the right way, go the route of, as far as I can see, Tim did not give you permission to do it. Am I right in saying that?
That's correct.
Okay. I mean, you did go to him and ask, right?
Of course,
right.
I did.
Right, okay.
And
so I understand that, but the thing is, the town of Hadley has a zoning law and rules that, you know, people, if they want to put up a dwelling or have a dwelling or whatever, they've got to go the right way, and they've got to go to get the permit, the correct permits, and make the payments for them permits, and do it the right way, even down to electrical. I kind of wonder how the electricity got hooked up on your trailer, to be very frank with you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you said you had to pay out quite a bit of money to have that done, and without permits, I really just don't get it. I mean, you know, there's a set of rules.
The electrician should follow the rules, too.
Well, you can see on my electrical contract that he was supposed to attain all the permits necessary, and he breached the contract. Where does that leave me then? It was very difficult from there on that point.
Who finally did the electric hookup to the house?
My father gained professional opinions. He got professional opinions from licensed electrician, as well as a hand from a licensed electrician who hooked the wire up from the house to the house. That was the only part that was left after the electrician.
And you do not have a town permit for that electrical hookup?
No, but I was trying to find a way to attain a permit for something that doesn't exist within the current rules, the current specific rules that are in the town. And I just want to reiterate that I am representing something that is a big movement. And I can't tell you how many emails I get constantly. There's a lot of people that are interested in tiny houses, and I'm just here to represent them. And I'm asking for the time so that the town can assess it fairly.
If she wants to put a tiny house up, why don't you go buy a lot?
Yeah.
Start from scratch.
Well, the easiest route for this,
either that or move it into a trailer park.
Mm-hmm. Excuse me. The easiest route for this right now, like in Amherst, they allow accessory dwelling units.
I don't care about Amherst. I live two houses up from you, ma'am. That house belongs in a trailer park.
Everyone has their opinion, it's true.
We're not going to sort through this tonight, so this is good conversation. But one thing I do want to highlight is, and this will come out more, is when Sarah was talking that she doesn't fall under the mobile home. That is going to be sort of key here, because there is a difference between the mobile home and what she's doing. It's upon us. And I will say this, and hopefully people take some comfort from this, that few people can do what she's done. You have to have the vision to do it. You have to have the money to do it. You have to have the skills to do it. You have to have a place to build it. you have to have a place to place it, and even through all that, you're still vulnerable that you may lose your placement. So there is a big difference, and again, we're not going to sort through that tonight, but I just want to put that out there, that it's not the same as going to an RV place, buying a home, and this is very different, and I just want to give that some thought.
Yes, sir.
My name is Jason. I met Sarah actually through this. I moved here a couple of years ago to finish my degree and liked it so much that I stayed. And as the gentleman in the front mentioned, students today are facing a kind of student debt that probably many of these people have never experienced. I graduated with $50,000 in debt from UMass. The idea that I'm going to be able to buy a lot or afford a mortgage right now is completely out of my range of thinking. It's impossible. So through Sarah, I know how sincere she is after meeting her, and she's actually encouraged me to go through the process of building a tiny home. In this process, I've actually gone seeing the kind of issues that have been coming up here in Hadley. I've been calling different towns, trying to get in touch with inspectors and trying to go through the process the right way, right up front. And I can, in most cases, not even get a call back because they don't know what I'm talking about. So I just feel like I admire what she's doing. I fully support her and the family who's letting her stay on the land. I also understand some of the concerns that some folks in town are raising about needing permits and having, you know, to have this process be above board. And I agree with that, too, and that's why I'm going through the process that I'm going through.
Well, you do realize that probably a lot of the town officials that have been asked questions that either can't or won't respond is because it doesn't conform to anything at this
point.
Well,
certainly, yeah. There's, and I think that's part of the really important part about what Sarah's doing is that she's saying there is this gray area. We have no idea how to classify it. We have no idea how to permit it. And she's, I think, asking to talk that out and to put that on paper. It's certainly a thing that's going to take time, but it's been effective in a couple of places around the country. And if we can make it be above board, I don't see. If we're willing to pay the money for permits and go through the process, why should we should be treated any differently than people who have the funds to buy a house or to buy a lot and build a house? We just need a place to live, and we're going to do it above board.
I have a question for Sarah. To go about the process in the right way, you've already mentioned that you have a bylaw petition, and the town meeting will meet to decide on that, correct? And that's going to happen in February,
yes.
Right? And also, I understand, I'm sort of getting, I'm concluding, rightly or wrongly, that you're going to go to a planning board meeting as well. Is that scheduled?
Well, as far as I know, there's a meeting on Tuesday the 16th.
Are you bringing materials to that planning board?
I'm going for information to gain insight, yes.
Okay. Well, my question is, this is a really nice forum for tiny houses, but if you went through these two steps, you wouldn't need to be here. You'd go through those two steps first, mm-hmm. and then might not need to be here at all.
Oh.
And they're very close in time. There's not a long wait here to do the bylaw petition and the planning board meeting. Am I correct in that?
Well, the she's not on your agenda at this point.
No, shut up, Jim. But I'm trying to answer your question about the time frame. The town meeting is scheduled in May, roughly. I'm not sure.
Well, hey,
is there a
date
scheduled for Richard?
That's when you have to have your petitions in.
February 17th, she has to have the petition or any warrant article to the town administrator. And then, depending on what the article is, that he will distribute to the appropriate department, in this case, to the planning board. The planning board will schedule a public hearing and such like that. So to be on the May town meeting for a amendment, she needs to have everything ready for February 17th.
Got it.
So it is not by any means, I don't want to say it's a lengthy process, but it's not a 1 month process either, mm-hmm. Okay?
But it is a process that she can go through and get all the proper elements in place to have done everything the way she should, following the law.
She needs to change, change the law, though, so it wasn't just a matter of not pulling the proper permits, because there was no permits to pull. So just a point there that it wasn't, that she didn't talk to the right people. The process involves submitting the warrant and which Jim's laying out there.
The answer is there's no answers because there's no zoning for this. That's what it boils down to. Yes, ma'am?
My name is Carol Smith. I live up on Lawrence Plain Road. And my worry with this is if this is allowed, that anybody who has a piece of property that they're not actually using could put campers on it or trailers on it, and then it would make a trailer park, and we don't want that. And they may not live there, and we have to live near it. So, you know, I don't want to set a precedent and then have someone, even though she says it's not a trailer, someone else take it as a trailer and decide that they can do that.
So we just kind of, as a point of order, what we do doesn't set precedent. So even if we were to, which is not in front of us tonight, but even if we were to grant a variance for this particular tiny house, it wouldn't set precedent that anyone can do that wants to do it. It would be decided on a case-by-case basis. So it's not a precedent-setting issue. In terms of getting the proper regulation in place, if there was to be some type of accessory dwelling bylaw, I would assume that would be something that would be addressed in the bylaw that would say, you know, only one per lot, only one extra accessory lot, only, you know, owner-occupied main home, things like that. That would be something that would be addressed in the bylaw.
Yeah, you say that, but we've been 10 years we've been fighting with a neighbor who's been putting campers on down by the river.
Yes.
And 10 years we've been going through this to try to get this stopped. He's told that he can only have one camper, and he has 10, 7 or 8 to 10 every year. This has been going on for 10 years. So I can't see where you're going to stop this.
I have to go to the fire department.
Ryan?
I think that she should follow the suggestion made here and do it the correct way. Petition the planning board, go to, and talk to them and go the route that you're supposed to. I mean, you're not going to go anywhere. Get anything ahead. I don't think you can just pull it into a town meeting and say, you know, I want this, and you know, it's going to happen. I think that her best route would be to go the proper route, and that has already been suggested to her, and I think that should be the way it should be handled.
Joe?
Yeah, I have two things. One is I'd like to hear from Sarah. You started to explain why yours was not a mobile home and you didn't get to finish. I would like to hear that.
Well, if you look up tiny houses on the internet, you'll get 1,000,000,000 blogs, but some actually define tiny homes. There's a lot of people that are trying to define them so that they can fit into a new criteria. Mobile homes, they have to be certified by a mobile home manufacturer, and they have separate systems. They have things that you have to do very specifically to comply with their specific codes. And tiny houses don't do that. We're not looking at mobile home codes. So that's the short answer.
Okay. And the second is, what I am hearing is that this woman has explored every alternative open to her through town governance, that she has gone to the proper officials and has been met by their confusion. She has gone and started a process to change the bylaw, which will not happen until May if it is a yes vote. I think she's really trying to do the right thing here. And I know that it's getting under the skin of some people who think that that there's a different way to do it and a different place to do it. But I'm seeing a sincere effort to comply with the wishes of the town, but the town has not been clear in stating what those wishes are. I would think it would make some sense for her to be granted the right to stay where she is, at least until after that town meeting vote, rather than having to yank up and then find another place and then come back. It's not that long a period of time. It's not setting precedent. It's the right thing to do, I think, in terms of somebody who's really tried to do right by the town and is frustrated.
I'd like to respond to Shell, if I can. I agree with you, Shell. The problem is that this particular meeting is to uphold or not uphold Tim Neihardt's judgment about it not meeting code. That's all we can do.
What happens if you find that she's not meeting code, which it sounds like...
No, he already said she's not.
Yeah, but I mean, what is the enforcement? That I'm asking now more about the enforcement end of things.
We don't really do that.
Well, the fines would, per section 6.1.2 of the zoning bylaw, would be a $300 fine per day.
Not to Sarah, to the owner of the lot.
And the violation notice has a couple different parts. So it is it's a cease and desist type notice. It's that puts her on notice that and the owners that there's an unsanctioned use under the bylaw, and then it also gives her a deadline of when to leave by, which is November 30th, 2015. She had a right to appeal it, which she's done, and that's why she's here. I think that we do have the ability, based on my understanding, to both uphold Tim's decision and to grant some form of relief in terms of an extended enforcement of that for a later deadline to leave, which. I think, in my opinion, I think that makes sense. I think this is an interesting conversation. It's an important conversation. It's a kind of a cutting edge housing issue that hasn't been addressed by our bylaws. And I'm hearing opposition from people, and maybe that opposition is going to carry the day at the May town meeting. But I think what Sarah's trying to do is to have a conversation about it, and you know, maybe it's going to lead to something, and maybe it's not. But I think that it's a worthwhile conversation to have, I think. So I think if we were to just straight up hold Tim's decision, kick her out of town, you know, maybe she's going to drop the process, and then we don't get to go through that process and come to a negotiated, you know, town vote on it. And then we'll just be dealing with someone else who comes in later on and does the same thing, as opposed to getting a...
Well, maybe the next person won't come in until they've got the proper zoning. Yes, ma'am.
Is the word you're looking for continuance?
Well, it's not necessarily a continuance, because I think we probably could continue the hearing. We could keep this, we could hold this hearing open.
Until... The town has the time to decide?
Well, I think some of the issues here is the fact that in the manner it was done, I mean, it was done clearly out of violation to the zoning bylaw, and clearly be out of the not knowing what the action that the people would take. And obviously it's come to the point where there needs to be an up or down on it, and clearly, because if this type of permission or taking advantage of non-permission is taken advantage of, you know, anybody can do this for anything, and then the town looks like we're wide open for anything anybody wants to do.
And I'd like to just repeat again, I said it earlier, but this board has sometimes very narrow constraints, and this appeal is specifically, I'll repeat again, to uphold or not uphold the zoning enforcement officer's conclusions or ruling, if you will. So, you know, to go beyond that, we'd have to be... I don't think we can go beyond that. We might be able to make conditions, but.
Bill?
Bill Dwyer, Planning Board. So logistically,
seems like you have two options. One is you could continue this for 5 months, for which you should get a written consent from the appellant, and then find out if it's moot after town meeting is over. Or alternately, if you want to proceed to uphold the order of the building inspector and then stay enforcement for 5 months, and see if you have to do it then. If you do it that way and the bylaw does pass, then he would not enforce it because it would be legitimate at that point.
It still negates the thing that...
Well, you uphold his decision.
Yeah.
But you stay the enforcement for a period of time.
Andrew, is that doable?
Yeah, I would be in favor of either of those. I think that makes sense.
It still doesn't negate the way it was backed into instead of doing it the right way.
Which is another reason to go with the enforce it, but stay, uphold but stay enforcement. That way you're making your point that it was not done properly because you're upholding the building inspector.
Yeah.
Well, the building inspector can enforce fines.
Yeah.
We can say those can be.
Any other comments? Well, what's your pleasure?
Yeah, I would make a motion then at this point to uphold Tim's decision, the zoning enforcement officer decision, on the November 3rd letter, and to stay the enforcement of it until after town meeting in May.
You have another comment? Yes, ma'am.
I think that you need to do things properly, and I don't think you can do something ahead of time and then ask for permission later.
I think town meeting scheduled for 5/5. Which is a Thursday.
I couldn't hear all of what you said.
I was saying, I would make a motion to uphold the violation notice, the ruling of the zoning enforcement officer, but stay the enforcement of it until May 6th.
The day after the town meeting. I second that.
All those in favor?
Aye.
I regretfully say aye.
Motion carries.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, basically what this means is that you need to get everything in place, not necessarily about your history in the movement, but about specifically how you can make that tiny house work on that property in compliance with the rules. And you may need to make some changes in order to do that, but you also are interested, very strongly interested in changing the bylaws, and so you'd be pursuing those two things. Not only the bylaw petition, but the planning board feedback information to help you get that in compliance. Did I miss anything?
No.
Okay.
That's it. Good luck on your petition.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Good
thank
luck.
You for your time. Thank you for all your comments, concerns, and support. Thank you.
Oh, does somebody have the attendance sheet here? Did I get that?
Yeah, I
If there's anybody who didn't sign the attendance sheet, would you do so, please?
Yes.
I don't know if you'd be interested by the